Ahar Torahim Tovim. Good afternoon to everybody. I'm happy to see a reasonably good crowd, even though we didn't have enough lead time to prepare this properly and get the really big hall, a 1,000-seat hall for this lecture, because I'm sure that we would have this audience if we would have enough lead time. In any case, I'm very glad that we have this opportunity to hear a presentation by a very extraordinary person. And I didn't know that before preparing for this event, but since then I read quite a lot, and what I read is really amazing, because we have had talks by astronauts before here. So it is not a new item to have a talk by an astronaut about how it is to fly in space, how it is to live in space. So I had in mind something, and I'm not sure whether we'll have this or not during this talk. Eileen Collins is a four-time astronaut. She flew four times in space. She's the first woman to fly, to pilot a space shuttle. She's the first woman to command a shuttle mission. She's the one that led this return to flight, space shuttle flight, after the previous disaster. And on top of this, or besides all this, she leads a normal family life. And I speak with a little bit of envy, because I'm married to a career woman, and we have children. And it's very difficult to be career persons and have a normal family life, because all things work against each other. And in fact, what I had in mind is a kind of explanation or a kind of handbook how to be a superwoman. I'm not sure whether Eileen will actually tell us the secret, but I'm sure we will learn quite a lot from this, and maybe we'll also learn something about the beneficial influence of carrots, if she wants to tell us about this. So without much ado, I'm going to ask Eileen Collins to give her presentation.
So I'll mic up here. Yeah, maybe I don't want to. Okay, and that was a joke for those of you listening. Okay, so STS-114 had two major goals of the mission, and they were both equally important. One of them was to resupply and fix the International Space Station. Some of the things on the space station needed to be fixed because it had been 2.5 years since the space shuttle. For example, there's four gyroscopes on the station. They're about this big and they weigh 600 pounds. And one of them had failed in 2002 and the other one failed in 2005. So we had to fix those. And we also resupplied the space station by taking up about 5,000 pounds of water, equipment, supplies, and science experiments. And we brought back about 6,000 pounds of garbage. And it's very important that we bring back what we don't need off of the space station, because if you have too much up there, there's less and less space and it becomes a safety problem. So that was our first major goal, was to get the space station in better shape. And the space station, when we left it, is in the best shape it has ever been. Right now on the station, there is a American astronaut and a Russian cosmonaut. And the station has been permanently manned for 5 years, and we're hoping to keep it without any interruptions, to keep it going. Okay, so space station was one of our major goals. The other major goal, which is equally important, was after the Columbia accident, there were several things that we needed to fix to safely fly again. And even the accident board gave us 17 recommendations, and we wanted to fulfill all of those before we flew again. And two of those major recommendations were inspect and repair. And you'll see that in the movie. The inspection was a major activity of ours. We had a robot arm, which has flown on the shuttle since 1981. We built a 50-foot extension to that robot arm so we could see farther. And on the end of it, we put cameras and lasers. And we inspected the wings, and we inspected the tiles, and we knew that we didn't have any damage. Well, we had some minor things that had happened, and which I'll talk about later. The other major objective on the to recover from the accident was repair. If you have a hole in the wing, or if you have a missing tile, or if you have something wrong with the outside of the shuttle, can it be fixed so you can safely re-enter? Well, we had four techniques that we tested on our mission that could fix different types of repair. And we know that we can't fix every possible type of repair that could happen to damage that could happen to the shuttle, but we can fix some types, mostly the smaller ones. And you'll see some examples in the movie of what we tested. One other thing I want to mention, the first time ever on our mission had the space station photograph. We came up from below, and once we were about 600 feet below, if you say this is the top of the shuttle, we pitched around and we exposed the bottom of the shuttle to the space station. And for about 7 minutes, we lost sight of the station while they took pictures of our tiles. When they did that, they noticed that there were some fillers that we called gap fillers. Anything that is protruding from the bottom of the shuttle, even if it's that small, could cause some unnecessary or unwanted heating on entry. So we had to fix those. At first, we were going to cut them off, and we decided, well, maybe we don't need to do that. Maybe we can just pull them out. So Steve Robinson went out on a spacewalk, and he pulled out two of these that were protruding. They weren't glued in there enough. That was the problem. So we had the first repair in space, the first real repair in space, and since then, we have fixed our procedures so the glue will work better, and we shouldn't have any more of those pop out on future flights. So that's some of the background. And I think what I'll do now is start the movie, and maybe we can, hopefully we can bring the lights down. And I'll be narrating this. Now, at the beginning of the movie, we're going to show you some scenes from training. Our crew trained for this mission I trained for 4 years, but the whole crew together trained. It's been a long road. Our ceremonial crew picture, which we're still passing out nowadays, of the seven of us that worked together on the mission. And I'll introduce the crew to you as we go through here. It starts out by showing some of our training scenes. This is a T-38 aircraft where we do acrobatic flying, we do formation, we do instrument flying. Okay, this is Jim Kelly. He is our pilot. Jim flew F-15s in the Air Force, and he's a test pilot. This is Soichi Noguchi from Japan. This was his first flight with us, and he did three spacewalks. That was his primary job. Steve Robinson also did three spacewalks, and in this next scene, you'll see that he is doing a training on a repair technique for a broken tile. This is Andy Thomas. He's from Australia, and Andy's job was to run the inspection where we had the lasers and the cameras. Wendy Lawrence is from the U.S. Navy, captain in the U.S. Navy, and she was in charge of transfer operations. I just let her do the job, and she did a really super job with it. Next to her is Charlie Camarda. He was on his first flight with us, and he also did transfer and inspection. This is the leading edge of discovery that we looked at before launch. And we finally made it to launch day after doing a launch scrub on July 13th. We went back into quarantine for 2 weeks, and we launched on July 26th. And there should be sound, by the way, on the next scene here. This is our strap-in. Wendy is getting into the mid-deck. Of course, the orbiter is on its back, and you strap it and you land your back for 2 to 3 hours, and it gets quite uncomfortable. But when you get to the moment of launch, it's all worthwhile. And there is sound here, if we can turn it up a little bit. I may have the control for that. Okay, we don't have sound. Okay, here's our launch. And you clear the tower going about 100 miles an hour on 6.5 million pounds of thrust. And we do the roll. Why do we roll? We align ourselves out over the Atlantic Ocean into a specific inclination to rejoin with the space station. This is a camera, a view from a camera that we put on the external tank for the purpose of looking for any damage or any debris that might fall off the tank. Of course, here's the booster separation and a nice view of the left booster from a camera on the right booster. And again, these cameras were there to look for anything unusual that might happen. Okay, we're fast-forwarding here to 6.5 minutes into the launch. The shuttle rolls to heads up, and that's so we can communicate with the satellites in orbit above us. And we're fast-forward here to 8.5 minutes. We ride on three-man engines until 8.5 minutes. You're now going about 25 times the speed of sound when your main engine's cut off, and you go from 3 G's of thrust into zero gravity. We separate from the external tank, and we do a burn to go up higher, and the external tank just falls back into the Indian Ocean, and it breaks up. And obviously, that doesn't fly again. It's an expendable tank. One of the first things we do on orbit is open the payload bay doors so we can get cooling. We got out the robot arm, and we started the inspection. And you can see the arm going along the wing leading edge as we look for damage. We didn't see anything unusual. There were a couple of scrapes, but it was determined that they were just that, and there was no damage. These video was very high resolution, unprecedented photos from orbit. You can see the hatch where we ingress and egress the orbiter. We don't open this in space. We do our spacewalks out of a different hatch. And our pilot was not in the schedule. He thought he would just do some nice pictures to send to the ground. And, of course, we waved to Mom and Dad. This is a burn. We get a small fraction of a G. And these three guys weren't working on the rendezvous, so they thought they'd goof around a little bit and have some fun. We're up to flight day 3 now, and we're doing a rendezvous with Space Station. That was the station that you saw out the window. Jim Kelly was running the checklist. I was flying. Charlie was in charge of the docking system, and Wendy was in charge of sensors. That she had a laser in her hand to give us the range and the range rate. So I have certain braking gates that I need to meet as I close on station. Now, here was the pitch-around maneuver that we did, or the flip. As soon as we got underneath the space station, 600 feet, we flipped the orbiter upside down, and the two astronauts in the space station had long lenses, very, very high-resolution 400, 800-millimeter lens, and they got excellent pictures that showed that these gap fillers had popped out, and they also showed that there was no other damage to the bottom of the shuttle. Now, this was the view that I had out the back window. The station is actually still, and it's us that is pitching. But it looks like the station is rising. You can see the solar arrays that are kind of gold, and you can see the truss and the radiators that are silver color. You see the Canada arm on the bottom, the space station arm, and the little circle just below middle is where I'm going to dock. Now, look above my head, and you'll see the space station coming down very slowly, or us going in very slowly. We close at 0.1 foot per second, very, very slow, And when I get just 2 inches away from station, I fire some extra jets to slam the 200-ton spacecraft together, and then the hooks, the latches and the hooks start automatically closing and pulling us together. And then we do a pressure check, takes an hour, equalize pressure, and we open the hatch. And Sergei Krikalev was there to meet us. Sergei is the commander of the space station, or he was at the time. And he pulled me in, and then he pulled the rest of the crew in. And we were very happy. They were happy to see us because they had been in space for 4 months. And we had coffee. There's the coffee going to John. And he was sending us emails begging for coffee for the whole time he was up there. And the Russian, or Sergei gave us some Russian bread, which is a tradition, and salt. Although in space your salt has to be salt water, because if you shook salt it would fly all over the place. And now this is a tour of the space station that Steve Robinson did with his handheld camera. So we started in the American segment, and it looks a little bit messy because there's cables and cameras and stowage, but this is actually very clean compared to what it was before we got there. They cleaned up for the visitors. So we're going through the American segment, and now we're going into the Russian segment. And this next, well, we came out of the laboratory, and now we're going into the FGB. This is the functional cargo block, which is Russian and mostly used for stowage. And it's mostly cleaned out. I would say about half of the volume you see right now was full of garbage that we had taken out and loaded up before we did the video. Just below us is where the Russians do their spacewalk, and in front of us is the service module where all of the control is done and where the cosmonauts live and work. They have a dining room table, which is something we don't have. And this is their control station here where they can do their navigation and control from. Here we're back in the American segment. This is Jim and Wendy. The robot arm is flown on the laptops. They don't have a window. They use the they use the cameras, and they project the picture onto the laptop, and they use that to fly the arm. This is our logistics module, which Wendy flew this and attached it to the space station so we could do our transfer. Now, most of the transfer got edited because the EDA guys wanted all their spacewalking things in here. So the next series of shots you'll see are of the spacewalks. Steve and Soichi are getting suited up. Those bags that they were swinging are their water bags, and they swing them to get the water on the bottom and the air on the top. To suit up, it takes about 2 hours. It's a very long process, and all these checks to make sure that there's no leaks. And then they went out the hatch, which is in the shuttle payload bay. And you can see, this is looking down, the camera is on the end of the arm looking down at Soichi egressing and going back to this tile repair board. Now, this is a board of tiles that we flew that had intentional damage on them, so we could go out and fix it. And these samples that were fixed were brought back to be tested in a laboratory to see if they would survive the heat of reentry. And from what I hear, they've done pretty good. But we only brought back about maybe 12 samples, so there's much more work that needs to be done. What you see here is a called emittance wash, and it is a fix for damaged tile. And Soichi is almost like an artist as he does this. And the previous shot was a material called Noax that is used to fix wing leading edge material. The next series of pictures are of the spacewalk where we changed the gyroscope. And Soichi actually held the 600-pound gyroscope in his hand. Of course, in space it weighs nothing, but on Earth it would weigh 600 pounds. And he had these beautiful views from the station looking down on the shuttle. As he did his work, he had to disconnect cables and electrical connections and bolts with a tool called a pistol grip tool. And he's on the end of the arm there. It took 20 minutes to fly him from the station down to the shuttle. We put the broken gyroscope in the shuttle, and we took the new one out and attached it to the station. And all four of them are working perfectly now. And so there's Soichi saying, "I did it." I told him to get back inside. No more playing around. Now, look under the nose of the shuttle here. You can see Steve on the robot arm. This is our third spacewalk on flight day 9. And Steve is removing the gap filler that I talked about earlier. And we were a little bit worried about this, and everyone in Mission Control was holding their breath. And we had this nice view from Steve's helmet camera. Over on the right side, he's pulling out the gap filler, which turned out to be extremely easy to do. The red is the glue that was supposed to hold the gap filler, but did not. And he brought, there were two pieces that he removed, and we brought both of those back inside. You can see them there. And we brought those home to be tested. The next scene you'll see is of a repair that would be done if we, like Columbia had, if we had a hole in the wing leading edge or a hole in our heat shield. We think that we could put this plug and screw it on the wing, but this is much testing that still needs to be done. Looking at some signs here, this is the human research facility. John Phillips is installing that in the space station. And now we'll have some views of the transfer activities. While you're watching that, I want to say something about human research facility. The space station is primarily being used now to do research on the human body and how we adapt to space and how we can improve the conditions of living in space for a long period of time. This is in the U.S. laboratory. We're moving some items from our logistics module into the shuttle. This is a water bag. We filled up 19 water bags. The Russians use water to generate oxygen. And this shows you some of the work that was done. I would say the vast majority of time on the mission was done packing and unpacking and transferring. And it's difficult to do this in microgravity because things float around and they don't do what you expect them to do. It takes a couple of days really to get used to it. And we're putting our logistics module away. This is flight day 10. On flight day 11, it was time for us to say goodbye, so we all signed the station logbook. And we said goodbye to John and Sergey. And I'm not sure if they were happy to see us go or if they were sad to see us go. I think we created a little bit of chaos while we were docked for 9 days. Here's the undocking. We actually close the hatches. We evacuate the air between the hatches, and then we undock. That's the station on top and the shuttle on the bottom. Jim Kelly did the fly around, and this now it's our turn to photograph the station. We wonder what the station's condition is. It had been 2.5 years since the shuttle was there, so maybe it got hit by micrometeorite or orbital debris, so we photographed the solar arrays you can see at the top. You can see the radiators shining along the two sides. And basically, we photographed the whole station and got some beautiful views of the Earth. Now we're going to look at some fun scenes. This is a water dump. We have excess water that we don't need, so we dump it out. It kind of crystallizes and looks like snow. It's some more silliness that we actually had an extra day in space because the first day, well, the day we're supposed to land at Kennedy Space Center, the weather was bad. So we had an extra day in space and we had some fun. That's the pistol grip tool that we use for in spacewalks. So we wanted to show people what living in space was like. We sleep in sleeping bags, and you can put the sleeping bag anywhere in the shuttle, and you can sleep anywhere you want. This is our exercise device. You normally do it with your legs, but I was doing my arms. And Charlie is showing you how to use the galley. We squirt water into our food, our dehydrated food. And sometimes we have some fun. This is lemonade. And Andy was showing us some tricks that he learned during his 4 months on a previous flight. And that's not a bubble. That is a blob of water, a blob of lemonade. And also we had Japanese food, so Suichi brought chopsticks, but we ended up eating with spoons most of the time. And the food is actually pretty good, but I wanted to come home and have some home-cooked food, too. Okay, it's time to come home now, so we had to put our orange pressure suits back on, and this is very difficult because you actually grow in space. You grow I grow about half an inch when I'm up there, so the suit's a little bit tight. But we put those on, we strap in, and we do a deorbit burn. And we enter the atmosphere about 25 times the speed of sound. So we're going extremely fast. From the Indian Ocean to landing in the United States, it takes about 1 hour. The colors outside were green and yellow and red. And this is a view out the overhead window where Andy was photographing this. It's a plasma flow that begins as the shuttle hits the air molecules, the friction breaks the electrons off, and you just get this plasma flow. And, of course, you get the heat. This is an infrared camera that shows the heat signature of the shuttle from the ground. This is at Edwards Air Force Base. Final approach, we're 300 knots. Coming down, we land at 200 knots. Here we drop the gear, and we're aiming at a runway that's 3 miles long. So touchdown after a very exciting mission, and it was great for us to be home. We took about an hour to get out of the shuttle because you have to get used to being in gravity again. It feels like, I tell people that I feel like I've lived my whole life in space after being there for just 14 days. Because it's so easy and fun, you'd get used to it. And when you come back to Earth, you wonder, did I spend my whole life here? Did I grow up here? This gravity it feels very uncomfortable. And it is. And you saw us walking around underneath the shuttle. We're very careful when we look at the tiles. You don't want to just throw your head back, because if you do that, you could fall over because you've lost your balance. And some astronauts adapt very quickly. In one day, they're back to normal, and some astronauts take up to a week to adapt. Now, before we take questions, I want to say a few things about the future of the shuttle program. Our mission last summer, I would say, was very successful, but we had one major problem, and that was a piece of foam that fell off the external tank, which was obviously something that we didn't want to happen. And this piece of foam fell off of an area of the external tank called the PAL ramp, which was an area that we never fixed. We didn't think it needed fixed. So after our mission, we went back to the drawing boards, and we have decided to completely take this PAL ramp off the external tank, so there's not only no foam, but there's no ramp, and then we obviously won't lose any debris in that area. So that work is being done right now, and that's why we're not going to fly another shuttle until May at the earliest. And we're not sure when we're going to fly because we don't have a date yet. But as soon as the testing is done, we'll fly when we believe it's safe to go. So how many shuttle flights are left? Well, we're going to try to fly 18 more shuttle flights, and then we're done. And we think we'll be able to do that by the end of 2010. The end of 2010, we'll stop flying the shuttle because that is what our president has asked us to do. And hopefully we'll get the 18 flights in that time period. We might get 19 flights. The purpose of the shuttle is to complete the International Space Station. We have a Japanese segment, we have a European segment, and commitments that we have promised, so we would like to fulfill those commitments. We'd also like to do a Hubble Space Telescope mission. And if we do that, we think it might be about 2 years from now, but we can't commit to that until we have finished doing all the safety upgrades that we need to do to make sure that a crew will be safe to go to Hubble. But Hubble is very important to us. As you know, we've gotten a lot of very exciting science, and we've learned a lot about the universe. So the astronauts would really like to extend the life of Hubble, and maybe we can extend it up to 5 years. One other thing I'd like to mention is what happens after we're done flying shuttle. Well, we have a plan. In 2012, we would like to fly the next generation spacecraft, which we're calling the CEV, the Crew Exploration Vehicle. That will take us to the space station. The same design will take us back to the moon. And we hope, if all that technology is tested and used and operating properly, that someday it can take us to Mars. So this Crew Exploration Vehicle is similar to an Apollo capsule. It doesn't have wings, but it has a heat shield, and it looks like Apollo, but it's has better technology, newer technology. It'll be safe for the crew because it's in line. You'll have the crew launch vehicle will be on a solid rocket booster, 5 stages. The crew will be at the top. The crew won't be able to get hit by any debris, And also, if there is an emergency on the launch pad or an emergency during ascent, the crew can eject safely and land safely if the launch vehicle explodes. So this should be a much safer system for the astronauts. And that development work is going on right now. And we haven't built the hardware yet, but we're hoping to be on a schedule to fly by 2012. So that's what we have to look forward to. I think it's a very exciting program. It's very doable because the technology is pretty much not experimental. And it's not as risky as some of the technologies we've tested in the past, like single stage to orbit and that type of thing. So I have a lot of hope that that we'll be flying in space in a new spacecraft, it's only 6 years from now. So with that, I think I'd like to open it up for questions, and we'll go as long as you'd like until they, I think we can go till about quarter after.
Thank you. Thank you. Right. We are going to take questions now, so anything pressing, anything you want to know? Yes,
how about
please?
The gentleman here? Okay, his question was about the Challenger happened in 1986. I was a student at Stanford University at the time, and I do remember I was driving to school to go to classes when the accident happened. And I had always wanted to be an astronaut, and in 1978 I decided I really wanted to be an astronaut because that was the first year that they selected shuttle astronauts. And I had been, I had been applying to the program up to that point. And of course it was a shock. I was very sad. I followed every bit of news about the accident because I was off at school. I knew no one at NASA at the time, but it didn't change my desire to be an astronaut. If anything, it made me want to do it even more. And I, you know, to this day, I sort of feel a kinship with the Challenger astronauts. I feel like I almost knew them, even though I didn't, because, you know, I think we all believed in the same thing, which is space exploration, and that despite the accident, we go on, we learn from our mistakes, we really learn from our mistakes, and we listen. And this is something that I talk to young people about, is the things that I do as an astronaut that I think are important are hard work and humility. And the hard work is obvious because everybody knows, if you're in college or if you've been to college, you know the importance of hard work. The harder you work, if you do it right, the better your result will be. But on the humility side, not everybody gets it when it comes to humility. You have to listen, and this is something we've learned at NASA. You've got to listen to everybody. You don't have to do everything everybody tells you. That would not be possible. But you at least have to consider what they're saying. So we listen and we learn, and that's things that we have learned from the accident because, yes, the accident was from a technical problem, but it was also from a problem of maybe people not listening and applying the things that they were warned about. Okay, question from this side of the room? Yes? Okay, his question is on by returning, I guess the next generation spacecraft will not be like the shuttle, it'll be like the Apollo design. Is that saying that the shuttle design was faulty? You know, I would say that at NASA we're in the business of testing new technologies and doing new things. Not everything that we do is going to work. I personally think the shuttle was an extremely successful program. You go back to 1981, you look at all the things that we've done. We've launched satellites, we've retrieved satellites. We've, you know, put up great observatories like Hubble and Chandra and the Gamma Ray Observatory. We've been able to go up and repair them. We had the MIR program, which was tremendously successful. And if you look at it from the point of view of the national coverage, it was all negative. But we learned so much from the MIR program, how to operate a space station, how to work with the Russians, how to get along with a country that used to be an enemy of ours during the Cold War. And now we work together wonderfully. And we are so much alike, it's you know, hard to believe what the history was. And the cosmonauts are our friends now. And we have the International Space Station, and we have countries from around the world that we work with. So the Shuttle has been a tremendously successful program. But I think what we've learned from Shuttle that was bad is when your re-entry, here's your tank, here's your re-entry vehicle, which is your Shuttle. It's down here. Stuff will always fall off of a launch vehicle, at least in my lifetime, unless we can. We're trying to keep things from falling off the external tank, but it's very hard. So if things are going to fall down on your reentry system, you have a major risk there. And we've learned from that, you know, in the future, let's not expose our heat shield to the debris from launch. So, but we've learned a lot of good things from the Shuttle, too. Reusable spacecraft. It's going to take me too long to talk about reusable spacecraft, but it's expensive. But it's also expensive to do expendables. But there's pros and cons to both. So I think we've learned a lot. And I remind people that NASA is a research organization and a testing organization. Once we get operational, we turn it over to whatever organization is ready to take that technology. But I think we'll find in the future the Apollo design or the Saturn V design is probably the safest way to go.
Let's take some
question. Do we have a young person? Here we go. Okay.
Micrography.
Okay.
You're pretty much as close to Earth. I mean, I don't understand why you float, because I mean you're as close. I mean, when you let go of the external fuel tank, it falls back, and it's not that much farther from the shuttle. And Earth gravity puts on the moon and on the planet. So why do you float from the shuttle?
Okay. Her question is why do we float in the shuttle, and understanding microgravity. We're actually not in zero gravity, we're in microgravity, but that micro is so small that your brain doesn't recognize it. As far as your brain's concerned, you're in zero gravity. When we launch in the shuttle, we launch into a suborbital, the initial launch puts us in a suborbital trajectory. So we separate from the tank goes back down because gravity's got it. If the shuttle didn't do anything, we'd go back down too. But we fight our at 40 minutes. And that puts us in a circular orbit. We must fire those engines or we're going back down into the gravity field. Now we're in a circular, pretty much a circular orbit. We still have gravity affecting us because that gravity is keeping us in Earth's orbit. But our brain can't detect it. For all intents and purposes, we're floating. Okay, so we're in microgravity. Now, if we stay up there long enough, eventually it'll decay and it'll bring us back down. We have to, over days, we have to fire our jets. The atmosphere is very small. We're at 200 to 300 miles. It's very small, but there's enough of it up there that the drag will eventually bring you back down. You're falling is what you're doing. You're falling in a circle. Did I answer your question? I can talk some more about it. Okay. We float, let's say I weigh 100 pounds on Earth. In the orbit that I'm in, I might weigh like a fraction of a pound because it's microgravity. And even less than that, actually. And that's not enough to bring my weight down. So I'm floating because there's nothing that's pulling me down to the center of the Earth. Now, if you're on the moon, well, it's the mass. It's, you know, I can do a physics lecture, but if two pieces of mass are attracted to each other. You don't really notice that at our mass because it's so small. But, I mean, the moon's there because it's being attracted by the Earth. And if you're close to the moon, you're going to weigh 1/6 of your normal weight. If you're close to Mars, you're going to weigh 1/3 of your normal weight. And then on the Earth, you'll weigh 1 unit of your own weight. So, But two bodies of mass, there's probably a physicist in here that can explain the law, where two bodies are attracted to each other based on the distance between them and the actual masses. And there's a constant in there, too.
Let's take a question from there. Yes.
Can I ask you one small question about the ideal system of the space shuttle? The leading edge of the space shuttle is protected by the reinforced carbon fiber, carbon composite.
Right.
And it can oxidize by air. So
right.
It's coated by silicon carbide, which by oxidizing provides silicon oxide here. What happens?
You want a job?
I'm a computer engineer at Intel. Okay. Space fan. And my question is, did the silicon carbide layer, is it fragile? And what happens if it's blown off? May it cause the loss of the RCC dial?
Okay, I wish I had Charlie Camarda with me because he is my crew member expert on this system. The wing leading edge is made of a material called reinforced carbon-carbon, RCC. It has a silicon coating on it. If that coating is damaged, even in the slightest, it will cause oxidation, which is bad, which means you'll get heat in there, and you can't have any damage to the coating, period. And that's what we were looking for in the inspection. And there's ways to do that, not just with cameras like your naked eye, but there's lasers. The lasers look for depth, and there's also an infrared camera. And there's several other types of technology that can see coating loss. But that was very good, so you're hired. How about a question over here? They've got a young lady up there.
What's the effect on your body when you land after
you land? OK, her question was effect on your body after you land. This is my favorite subject because I'm just fascinated by it. I go up into space, and I love it because you're floating, and you spin around, and you have fun. And you know, you learn a whole new world. It's like when you first learn how to roller skate, but it's in not just two dimensions, but three dimensions. But when you come back to Earth, I'm uncomfortable. You know, I usually have to have somebody pull me out of my seat because you got that big heavy suit and they pull you out of your seat. And it affects your vestibular system, which is kind of your balance, because your inner ear is a little bit kind of used to being in space. It's a little bit messed up. And you'll tend to maybe fall over a little bit easier. So people kind of walk next to us and make sure we don't fall over. And the other thing is you're weak because you haven't used your muscles. And we run on treadmills, we run on ergometers, bike on ergometers, but it's not enough. You do it 30 minutes a day, it's really not enough compared to what you do on Earth. So your muscles are weak, so your muscles are going to be sore. The day after landing, you're sore. My feet hurt very bad the 2, 3, 4 days after landing. I hadn't walked on them, and now I'm walking on them again. So some people have backaches. There's a whole list of things that people have, and it's different from one person to another. Astronauts are in excellent shape. I would say, I like to talk about older people. I think if you send older people into space, I think about my grandmother and when she had trouble getting out of the car and she had trouble getting out of her chair. And my first mission in space, I said, I wish she could be up here because she could do everything, because everything would be easy for her. But then when I went back to Earth, I thought, wow, if we send old people in space, we can't bring them back. because they might, I mean, they may not make it, you know, depending on your, you know, how strong you are. And it's very difficult to come back to Earth. And that's why we work out a lot and we make sure that we're, the situation we're concerned about is if there's a landing in, let's say, we have a fire and we have to escape quickly from the shuttle, the way we feel is not very good. And for us to get up and run out of the shuttle, open the hatch, put the slide out, and run out with all that weight of the suit on us, it's going to be difficult. And we may have to rescue some of our crew members. They can't move, especially those that have been on station for 4 to 6 months. And so we actually practice emergency landings where we take 150-pound, 200-pound dummy and haul them out, and we practice that because we hope we never have to do it. But we're looking at countermeasures. We drink salt water, a lot of salt water before we come home, because the salt water will stay in your system for a couple of hours. It keeps you hydrated, and it keeps your brain from getting, it keeps you from getting this rush of fluid out of your brain after you land, so you don't faint or have vestibular problems. I could go on and on. This is my favorite subject, but you know, on a layperson's level, I'd just like to leave you with, it's a challenge, and it's something that NASA medical people are working on because it's so important to safety. But how about somebody from way up in the back there? The gentleman in the black shirt.
Is it possible up to date
global planning, U.S. Army,
Okay, I'm not sure I understood the first part of your question.
I'd like to ask if it's possible to do the unmanned, to do the mission unmanned.
Oh, of the shuttle? Okay, now that is actually a very good question because since the Columbia accident, we looked at returning a shuttle unmanned. Now, right now, we don't have a reason to launch a shuttle without astronauts. But if you went up into space and docked with the space station and then found out you had a hole in the wing and you couldn't come back, what we would do is send the shuttle back without people. So we have actually done a lot of work on. The shuttle can fly back, it has an autopilot, and it can land, or it could fly into the ocean if you had to ditch it, but you would have to start the deorbit engines, and you would have to close the hatch, and you'd have to put the orbit targets in there. There's certain things that have to be done to get the shuttle out of low Earth orbit, and we've worked on those at NASA, and we have a system to now bring a shuttle back unmanned if we had to. So. And we really don't work on that unless we have a reason to. And it wasn't until the accident that we had a reason to do that. No reason to fly shuttle. It's actually cheaper to send robotic missions like the ones we sent to Mars, the landers on Mars. It's better to design another system. The shuttle is very much built for humans to operate. So no reason. We probably could do that, but it'd be too expensive. Let's see, do we have anyone have a question on this side? I don't think you've asked a question yet. Go ahead.
Well, my name is Mordechai. Before I state my question, I want to say I think I speak on behalf of everyone here. You're a remarkable woman.
Oh, thank you. I have two kids, too.
The question is there some sort of indication or an estimate How long can one stay up there, God given everything is okay with the shuttle?
Well, how long can someone stay in space? We don't know. The record is 444 days, which is held by a Russian doctor named Polyakov, and I'm forgetting his first name now, Polyakov. I have actually never met him, but I've waved to him through the window on my first mission, and he... I don't know the results of his, because it's the Russians have it. I don't know the results of his mission. Oh, yes, he's still alive. Yeah, he's doing well. As far as I know, he's doing well. But what we're doing now, we could put someone up in space for longer if we wanted to, but I think it's more important that we get more data points. And, we really only have a few. I mean, how many astronauts have flown 4 to 6 months? Many cosmonauts from Russia have maybe... 15. I'm just guessing. I have to go back and count. But from the United States, we don't have many data points. We want to fly more people. We do medical testing on them. The astronauts are very good about volunteering themselves to medical research, and some of it is hard. It's not the kind of thing everybody would volunteer for in medical testing, but we do that because we need to determine how well does the heart do, how well do the muscles do. We lose calcium out of our bones. We know our bones get weak in space. Astronauts have lost up to 11% of bone in certain parts of their body, like the ankle. You lose a lot of bone in your ankle. And you can get some of that back when you come back to Earth, but you never get it all back. And we can learn a lot about Earth, diseases we have on Earth and aging that we have on Earth. We think we can't by going into space. So we want to get more data points because people are different. And people react to medicines differently. People react to spaceflight differently. So it's more important to us to fly more people, lots of six-month missions. Maybe someday we'll go longer. But we know if we go to Mars, and we know the moon's about 3 days to get to the moon, and then we can stay there we plan on staying there for much longer than the Apollo missions, 1-2 months maybe, and eventually longer. Mars is what we're really looking at as far as how long can people stay, because a trip to Mars can be 6 months if the planets are aligned, same side of the sun basically. But if the planets are opposite sides of the sun, worst case, maybe 2 years under conventional propulsion to get to to get to Mars. So we're talking many years for a person in space. On Mars, you get one-third gravity, but you still won't get, you know, your body still won't be what it, doing what it's used to in one unit of gravity. I'd also like to say, I would like to see propulsion technology advancing much faster. Conventional propulsion can get us, like I say, to the moon in 3 days, but eventually going to Mars and other places, we need to get there faster. We need our communication signals to be faster. I believe they can be faster, but it's going to take a revolutionary breakthrough. Some people are doing research on nuclear electric propulsion to get us places faster. There's a lot of work that needs to be done, and I'd like to see a major breakthrough in propulsion, and someday people will be able to travel outside of the solar system, because we're just discovering now there's planets. Maybe we'll discover Earth-sized planets, and you know, this is a dream of mine. I hope it happens sometime in my lifetime that we can have a leap in technology to get places faster, and then we don't have to worry as much about being in microgravity for long periods.
I'm afraid that this is going to be the last question, so you select.
Do you want to pick the last person?
No, you select it.
Okay, let's pick a young person. Okay, how about the young lady in the red shirt or maroon shirt? Okay, I did not do any experiments. Back in the old days, the Shuttle, or even on Columbia, on the 107 mission, they did a lot of experiments. That was their mission, to do experiments. And now my first and second mission, and actually my first three missions, I did experiments. This mission was, see, now that we have the space station, the experiments are done on the station. So our job was to take them their experiments and to bring back the work that has been completed. So I personally didn't do any on this mission, but I have on my previous missions, and they've included plant growth, which I've enjoyed doing those. I've done some fluids experiments, and I've done experiments on myself where, you know, you're just kind of looking at reactions to the human body in space. And as a pilot, my job is to operate the shuttle, and the mission specialists have done most of the experiments. Mm-hmm. And let me say that science is important, but we have, as a shuttle astronaut, we have now, I would say, turned over most of the science experiments to the station astronauts. So that human research facility that I showed you in the movie has a whole suite of experiments that the station astronauts can do on themselves for, you know, checking for, you know, changes in their, you know, blood or calcium in their bones and that type of thing.
Okay.
Okay.
Since you're here as part of the, Eileen is here as part of the annual memorial for Eleanor Mon, which is tomorrow, February the 1st. Perhaps the, I wanted to say just a couple things. They're here for 5 days. There are three astronauts. We split them up today. Eileen is at the university, one is at Schneider Hospital, and one is at a school. And they will be visiting 8 other schools. They will be visiting Air Force bases. They've met with the Prime Minister. They've met with the President. And they have initiated, we also, on this anniversary, have 3 spouses and family from the Columbia families, because 7 peaks in Tel Aviv were dedicated in honor of the Columbia family. And we're blessed by having in town Lanny McCool, whose husband was William McCool, the pilot. Laurel Clark's husband, Jonathan Clark, is here in Israel. And Douglas Brown, David Brown's brother, is here in Israel to join Rona and take really a break from their personal anniversaries to be part of the Ramon family. The other thing I wanted to tell you is 2 things. Because it's part of the anniversary, we have a, Ilan not only wore the NASA sticker and the American flag, but underneath his spacesuit he had a personal crest which stood for many of the symbols that that he flew for. And we have a crest for every a sticker of the crest for everybody as you leave. Also, Eileen's sort of been a little easy today. Can I have a signal of how many people would like her to sign just something? And if it isn't too overwhelming, she may just do it. How many people here? So I know. So can we count together? 1, 2, 3,
four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11.
Wow.
I see 15. I know there'll be 30. But what I would like you to do is, if you'll line up on that side nicely, remember that there's a large number. Remember that she's doing it graciously, so it's for you and you for you alone, and please consider that and out of respect to Eileen. The final question for Eileen is, you knew Eileen.
Yes.
Tell us how you knew Eileen.
Well, I thought Eileen was a very humble person, and I thought he was very smart, and I thought he was very motivated and very interested. Obviously, he was extremely interested in what we were doing, and he loved his crew very much. And my only regret is that I didn't get a chance to fly with him in the T-38. We used to email each other, and I remember when Columbia went out to Palmdale for its major modification, Eileen was in Houston. His crew wasn't assigned yet, so he was like, Eileen, well, you know, let's go fly. And we were never able to get together, and I regret that. I wish we had had a chance to fly together. I thought I'd always have a chance to fly with him later. But he certainly is a great man, and we hold him in, obviously, we hold him in very high esteem. And almost anything I could say is insufficient, but I think you're very lucky to have him as a, I'd say, a space explorer from your country, and I think you can be very proud of him.
Let me close this this session with the necessary thanks. The visit of the astronauts and their families here is made through the courtesy of the Ministry of Science and Technology in Israel. This special event is made by the auspices of the School of Physics and Astronomy, who provided funding, and the efforts of the Astro Club, the Tel Aviv Astro Club, that is making a lot of activity concerning space, astronomy, sciences in general, and everything. Anyone who does not know about the Astro Club is invited to go here and to take a list of their future activities and sign up for the mailing list. Thank you for your attention.
I also forgot to mention I have a memento of our trip into space that I will leave with you with some pictures of some of the things I showed in the video today. Thanks.
It's been a long road getting from there to here. It's been a long time, but my time is finally near. And I can feel a change in the wind right now. Nothing's my way, and I'm not gonna hold it down no more. No, they're not gonna hold me down. 'Cause I've got faith of the heart.
My patent is another thing.